On hot copy, the lower house previously vowed to pass the proposed budget on October 1, but with only around 2 weeks left and several issues still lingering in certain departments, the lawmakers still be able to deliver on their self-imposed deadline. Joining us now, House Committee on Appropriations Senior Vice Chair Marikina Representative Stella Kimbo. Representative Kimbo, welcome to the program. Good morning.
Good morning, Mike. Thanks for having me.
All right, so I know it's been the past few days, it must have been long for you at the House Appropriations Committee, but how are budget deliberations coming along and are we on track to meeting that deadline, October 1?
Before I answer your question, maybe just a quick correction. We did not pass the budget of the OVP yesterday. So we simply had a briefing during the hearing. So hindi pa po approved. So remember that we still have to go through the plenary debates and our internal deadline is October 1. And we are absolutely on track. Just to answer your quick question, we are on track. We've had 33 of the expected 38 budget briefings. We'll be having four today. So we'll be having only one tomorrow. So this week concludes budget briefings. Next week, we begin plenary debates.
Let me just go back to that correction, Representative Kimbo. So what was passed was only during the House Appropriations Committee?
We did not pass anything.
Ah.
No, we did not approve anything.
All right.
So what we have right now are simply briefings. This is in preparation for the plenary debates, which will begin next week.
All right. So thank you for that clarification, because all reports have stated that the budget was passed for the OVP, at least at the House panel level. So thank you for that. But
yes, and this is parliamentary courtesy that we do every year to a co-equal branch of government. So every year po yan, this is not the first time.
So, but the Makabayan lawmakers have been questioning that parliamentary courtesy be extended to a co-equal branch. So I suppose it's not just the office of the president, the office of the vice president, but also the judiciary that you're also extending this courtesy?
Well, we had a short briefing by the judiciary because they were asking for a big increase in their budget. So it was good for us to listen to them. But which is not the case for OB and the OBP.
And that leads to the question, Representative Kimbo, of should we reconsider this parliamentary courtesy practice? I suppose it's not a rule, right? Because the question is, how can we dissect where that $500 million, for example, confidential fund of the OVP would go to if there's no deliberation?
We've been dissecting the budget since they submitted the budget to us many weeks ago. There are many venues to do that. We have like simultaneous briefings. This is like the formal set of briefings. But on top of that, there are simultaneous briefings happening on the side. Siguro mga three sets altogether. And then when we get to the plenary debates, yun yung mapapanood ng mga tao. So that's the formal dissecting of the budget happens on plenary. So wala po tayong skin and skirt dito. Every day nandito ang mga congressmen since we received the budget, and talagang we've been on, you know, hindi lang naman sa nakikita natin sa TV, di ba, or narinig natin sa radyo. Nagkatrabaho po kami even outside the public's view.
That I understand. So what are the more contentious items now when it comes to the 2023 proposed budget that you're looking into?
Well, in general, Mike, unlimited wants versus limited funds.
Yes.
That's the main problem. Every single agency that went to us and briefed us on their budget, isa lang talaga ang hinaing. Kung ano ang hiningi nila sa DBM, ganito lamang ang na-approve. So that's really throughout pretty much all agencies. Of course, as you go from one agency to another, iba-iba yung sinasabing kakulangan. In the case of POH, for example, it's the arrears in the payment of frontliner allowances. Yan ang malaking problema nila. And I think ang arrears is 64 billion as of this year. And then they requested 74 billion for next year. But I think they only got approved at below 20 billion. So that's an example. And then a second recurring issue is devolution. So as you know, after the Mandanas ruling was issued by the Supreme Court, nagkaroon ng parang increased appetite in finally implementing the devolution of certain services to the LGUs, which means services like health, for example, will now be the responsibility for the provision of healthcare will now be moved to the local government. And of course, the big issue there is, are LGUs ready? Are LGUs capable? Do LGUs have the necessary finances to be able to actually implement or provide those basic services? And as you go from one agency to another, you know, tinatanong din, what are your devolution transition plans?
And one of the items you mentioned, the budget for health, that has been a contentious issue because the COVID budget has apparently been cut from, as you said, 74 million proposed by the Department of Health to just about 20 million by the DPM. How do you intend to go about this? Because as we've learned from this year, apparently the budget for SRA of health workers could not be funded. That's about 1 billion pesos, partly because that was actually placed under unappropriated or unprogrammed appropriations. So are we seeing that again in this particular budget? And how do we hope to remedy that?
Well, first of all, let me just explain that unprogrammed appropriations, all that means is it's a standby appropriation. So as soon as excess revenues are made available, then those particular items can now be funded. Now, of course, it sounds like a concern. It would seem like it's a low priority. But let me assure you that historically, nagkakaroon naman ng excess revenues. And so, for example, last year, the SRA allowances that were in unprogrammed appropriations were in fact funded. I think about 42 billion of the unprogrammed appropriations for allowances were eventually released. So it's really just a matter of practice in DBM that certain expenditure items can actually be put in unprogrammed, but then eventually napupunuan din naman. So going back to your question, I guess, as we know, COVID cases are significantly lower today than what it was previously. So, and the budget is really an economic recovery budget. Again, the premise is maybe, and as reported earlier, the pandemic is probably about to end, right? But be that as it may, meron pa ring nakalaan na pondo para sa COVID response. So we still have funds for COVID booster shots and again, some funds for allowances. And of course, most importantly, one of our learnings during the pandemic is that kulang na kulang talaga ang ating hospital capacity. So, and in fact, it's a directive of the president, as he said in his SONA, it's his priority to help expand health facilities. So one important item in the DOH budget is the Health Facility Enhancement Program, which I believe there's about 22 billion pesos.
You talk about hospitals, but there was a cut of about 880 million pesos for specialty hospitals like National Kidney Institute, for example. And there was also a different cut, about 900 million for the PGH. How will you intend to go about this? What are the proposals at the moment? Do you intend to refund or perhaps give back those cuts to these hospitals?
Can I explain? There's really no cut if you compare the NEP amount. So the NEP, the National Expenditure Program amount, that is the amount proposed by the executive to Congress. And if you compare the NEP amounts of 2022 and 2023 for these hospitals, there actually was an increase. All right? There was an increase. So what people are saying as there was a decrease is a comparison of the 2023 NEP and the 2022 approved, which is the 2022 GAA. Right, yes. Meaning yung lumabas sa Congress. So historically, all that means is historically, many legislators propose amendments. They propose increases for these hospitals because ano eh, it's obvious, right? These specialty hospitals are really, really critical facilities in our healthcare system. So ramdam naman namin yon na Congress people, and therefore, at a proper time, meaning during plenary debates, at the what we call period of amendments, many legislators do propose increases for these specialty hospitals, especially PGH. Historical po yan, talagang nadadagdagan yan during the period of amendments, or even most particularly no, sa BICAM.
Mm-hmm. The other day, Representative Kimbo, you raised concern about the proposed budget of PhilHealth. It was increased from 800 billion to 80 billion to 100 billion. Again, we're comparing the GAA to the proposed budget for 2023. What were your concerns about that?
Well, first of all, tandaan natin that the increase in our total budget is only about 244 billion. So, so yung increase from 80 to 100, which is 20 billion, is a significant portion of the total increase, right? So we need to make sure that it's a proper amount. But when I asked them about the number of beneficiaries to be covered by that 100 billion, it was not clear to me. It would seem like there is like an overstatement of the number of indigent families. Meaning to say, they say that it is to cover 12 million indigent families. But as far as I know, based on the National Health Targeting System list, ibig sabihin yung listahan na ginagamit ng DSWD, as far as I know, there are only about 6 million families. So I asked them about that. So parang, how did you move from 6 million families in the NHTS list to 12 million, right? Mm-hmm. And of course, that's a big difference. And so that was my concern. It's a very nuanced explanation. We'll need another hour for that. But basically, yun yung bottom line. Parang hindi masyadong maliwanag ang basihan kung bakit nagkaroon ng 20 billion increase. Remember, yung binibigay na budget ng gobyerno to PhilHealth is to subsidize the premium contributions of the indigent families.
They're supposed to earn because it's a GOCC, right? It's supposed to earn.
And it's supposed to, well, yes, it's supposed to earn on their investments, right? Kasi meron silang reserve funds. They're required to keep reserves. And of course, you reserves mo, you can earn interest on that. So that is also the other thing that came out. Marami silang reserves. It's way more than what is required by law at the minimum. Which is, you know, so it's good. That means it's a, it's in the pink of health. But of course, if it's too much, that's also a problem. Kasi ibig sabihin, hindi natin nagagamit yung pondo sa dapat pinagagamitan.
So does this mean the 100 billion allotted to PhilHealth under the NEP will probably be reduced in the coming days? What's the prospect of that?
Well, again, they have a justification. Ang sa amin naman, as long as you show us the justification, that there should be no problem. No, at least in theory, yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right. Now, what about the other aspects of the budget, Representative Kimbo? The libreng sakay, for example, because that's been a big issue. The government promised. That's I think President Marcos did say libreng sakay would continue, but apparently there's no allotment for libreng sakay.
Yes, we were all disappointed to hear that there's a zero proposed budget for libreng sakay, and as you know, so this is our way of coping with fuel price hikes, especially for our students. And in fact, it was also, I believe, an announcement by the president na magkakaroon ng libreng sakay for students. So of course, we're hoping that in 2023, mapagpatuloy yan. But
around how much will this cost, libreng sakay? How much are we looking at?
I can't remember how much they proposed, but all I remember is that they got zero. So again, ito yung isang malaking problema ng Congress. Again, the reason for why we need to look at the proposed budget is, of course, we need to know if what the executive proposes really aligns with the needs of the district. So we all represent the people. So as representatives, we really feel the need for safety nets because of the fuel price increases. And we're looking at libreng sakay as one mechanism. Of course, there are many other ways, no, to help, but this is one important mechanism. So yan ang challenge namin, how we can like try to get funds from other programs which we feel are maybe overfunded, in a sense that baka wala naman capacity ang agency na i-absorb ang funds na yan for that year, and therefore we can probably move some of those funds to programs like Libreng Sakay, which we feel are really urgently needed.
And Representative Kimbo, there was an expose yesterday by Senator Alan Peter Cayetano, supposedly about parking of funds with the DPWH. And this is not a new accusation. It's just saying that for this year, there's supposedly this scheme of parking funds with DPWH. Are you going to look into that?
Well, you know, first of all, I was really surprised. So kung talagang may ganyan, maganda natitignan nga ng ating former speaker, Alan Peter Cayetano. Of course, tomorrow, ang DPWH budget briefing dito sa Kongreso, imposibleng hindi sila tanungin. So tomorrow is going to be an important hearing. So dun sa sumusubaybay dyan sa issue na yan ay dapat makinig bukas.
Mm-hmm. So how many more are you going to conduct until October 1, Representative Kimbo? How many more hearings? And what's lay down for us what will happen in the next weeks?
All right. So at the committee level, we have the budget briefings. Mm-hmm. So today, we will have 4. So by the end of today, we would have finished 37. Mm-hmm. And so one more to go tomorrow because our total of 38 agencies that are set to give us briefings. By next week, starting Tuesday, we will begin plenary debates. So it's another round. It's another round. But this time, ang magsasagutan sa plenario would be representatives. Unlike sa budget briefing, ang sumasagot is mismo yung ahensya. But in the plenary debates, it's the sponsor of the budget, meaning the congressperson who is assigned to defend the budget. Yun po ang sasagot sa mga nagtatanong. And that's going to happen for from September 20 to September 28.
Mm-hmm. So how's the working relationship so far of the committees? I mean, the committee members with the chairman, how's it going coming along?
So far, so good. Pag-good kaming lahat, pero mukha naman mataas ang moral. Our chairman is super hands-on. He attends all hearings. He pretty much opened all hearings except for a couple, one or two na because he had something equally urgent to attend to. So, okay naman. Our chairman kasi, ang description ko sa kanya, he's a successful provinciano. And that brings in a lot of perspectives, new perspectives. And he's really good with numbers. Hindi niya kailangan ng calculator. Kaya niyang mag-add, subtract in a second. Kaya, okay, I think it's a really good team.
And what about the support? What kind of support are you getting from the House Speaker?
Oh, nako, isa pa. Bagay sila, actually, they're a very good team. Kasi super hands-on din si Speaker. Nababantayan talaga niya lahat. He knows kung ano, we're super, extended na masyado. Alam niya, he really manages time very well. So, yan ang role niya sa amin to remind us that we have a deadline. Importante, Mike, that we approve the budget by October 1 kasi kung hindi, meron tayong risk of having a reenacted budget. Ang problema sa reenacted budget, so ibig sabihin nun, uulitin mo yung budget in 2022 for 2023. Ang problema nun, marami sa 2022 ang na-implement na. Construction of classrooms, construction of roads, etc. So which means, hindi mo na yan magagawa next year. And remember, naghahabol tayo with economic growth. Yes. So there are many things, particularly the infrastructure projects, that we need as really a vehicle for growth. So if we have a reenacted budget, that's really going to be very bad for our economy. And that's why that's the pressure, that's the stress that we are, that's the burden today of Congress. We really need to approve it by October 1.
Do you see any hurdles in meeting that October 1 deadline? What outstanding issues, thorny issues might come in the way of that?
Honestly, it's really the tight schedule. It's really the tight schedule. But historically naman, like in the last 3 years, it's my fourth year in Congress, it has always been that tight. At naitatawid naman namin. Of course, ngayon merong COVID factor, pero but because we're really very careful, lahat ng taong pumapasok, nag-antigen testing. So far, we've been okay.
Mm-hmm. But what would differentiate what's happening now? How would you compare it to instances in the past when we have a reenacted budget? Were the hearings really at that time really protected that you know that you won't be able to meet the deadline?
Unfortunately, I can't answer that question. I was not a member of Congress.
All right, I understand.
But yes.
All right. So So what should people look for ordinary viewers, actually, Representative Kimbo, who might not appreciate the numbers that we're mentioning right now, what should we look into when trying to appreciate this budget hearings?
Well, syempre, remember, you know, this is the budget that will fund services for the public. Mm-hmm. So if you feel burdened, for example, by fuel price hikes, isa kang GP driver, and you feel like ang konti na lang ang kinikita mo ngayon because you have to pay more for gas or diesel, then of course you look forward to, teka muna, ano makukuha kong tulong mula sa gobyerno. And so then when you hear stories like there's zero budget for libreng sakay, then it becomes a concern. So ganun eh. You really need to think about what you urgently need today. Again, mm-hmm. I go back to this unlimited wants, limited mm-hmm. funds, right? But dun sa unlimited wants mo naman na yan, may priority din naman yun, diba? So, dapat bantayan natin na yung pinaka-basic needs natin dapat matugunan. So, of course, nandiyan ang rice. That's why ang laki-laki ng budget increase for DA, and we completely support that. It's about time that mabigyan pansin na ang agriculture sector na taon-taon, it has always been the laggard. So we welcome this development that finally we're putting in the needed attention to agriculture, and particularly to rice, right? Because that's, I think it's about 60% of of our budget. So if you have, if you're able to address rice prices as well as transport, malaking bagay na yan sa welfare ng bawat Pilipino. And of course, education mm-hmm. din pala, of course, para sa ating kabataan.
Mm-hmm. All right, on that note, thank you so much for joining us this morning, Representative Stella Kimbo.
Salamat.